Hey guys, yeah, I must be crazy doing this late at night. Might not be crazy if I lived in a house, but I got neighbors. Upstairs to the sides of me. I don't think I'm disturbing anybody to the sides of me. I think that's their kitchen next to my wall here. I'm not sure. But I got people upstairs. Actually, I think it's their kitchen too upstairs. So unless they're in the kitchen, I'm not disturbing them. Oh man, where do I start? You know, I did my Thanksgiving, quote, special about a week ago, intending to do a part two, and I never got around to it. But I'm trying, to do, more frequent, and I'm still experimenting with the sounds and the sound mix. I'm ticking around with it, but the music was too loud before, and it might still be too loud now. I'm still working on it. But I'm using a microphone, which you can't see, but it's right here. The tip of it is just missing the screen. I'm using my professional microphone, and I'm actually using my DVD player to play a CD. And instead of doing what most of the VC does and tell you what music is playing at the end of the video, maybe I'll tell you now. Yeah, I'll tell you now. A while ago, wonderful Jeff, Mr. Vinyl Spin, who does videos, sent me a package, and in one of the things in the package, we had talked about Tomita. I think this was maybe close to his passing, and actually, thanks to Jeff including a little note in his card here, in May 16th of this year, 2016, he sent me... He sent me a package, and in the package was this, the one Tomita album that I really wanted. I'm not a completist, I don't have much of his stuff, but the certain time element that I had, and one of the things that I wanted was his album that goes by a couple different names. In America, it was released as Bolero, and he sent me this sealed vinyl version of Bolero. I did listen to the vinyl, but I didn't get a chance to copy it into my computer, which I almost always do. I rarely listen to vinyl because, as I've mentioned, my turntable is defective. And without any kind of warning at random points, one of the channels just turns itself off. So I pretty much only use my turntable when I want to transfer some vinyl, something that hasn't been re-released on CD, into my computer so I can have it in my computer so that I can burn it onto a CDR disc. It's quite an effort because, as I said, at random points, the channel turns itself off. So instead of just playing a vinyl once through and then editing the songs and chopping up the songs, you know, so that you have separate tracks on the CD, I have to take, it takes at least like, what I used to do is I used to actually take an album, play side one, flip the album over, play side two, and then edit the file afterwards while the file was recording in the computer. But I can't get, you know, I don't get through 5-10 minutes without one of the channels dying, so I have to do it song by song by song. You know, so I do song one, have to check the file to see if the... if one of the channels turned off during the recording. If it did, I got to do it again and again. It usually takes about a half a dozen tries for each track to get a good copy of the track where the channel doesn't turn itself off at some point, you know, some random point in the track. So it's a lot of work to get a hunk of vinyl onto, you know, into my computer done perfectly, and so I could burn it onto a CDR disc and play it from there, or just play it from the files that I keep in my computer. I only have one album left that I want to do that to. One album that hasn't been re-released on CD. So, and that's not even a musical thing. It's an old Pickwick record of ghost stories. Hopefully that one will be a little bit easier to do. I won't be quite as concerned with the surface noise and that kind of thing like I am with vinyl albums of music. But, so Jeff had sent me this. I was talking to him about it. For some reason, this was on RCA. RCA, you know, that was, yeah, you know, at the time, and this is from the mid-70s, oh, this is from actually 1980, when RCA was, you know, releasing Tamita's stuff, and still does, like, his classic era stuff from the 70s, mostly. They've released CDs of, but they didn't release this on CD. Now, only in America was this album, confusingly, called Bolero, which it does, there's an electronic version of Bolero on here. Overseas, it was called Daphne and Chloe, which is another piece on here, on the album. And Jeff told me very nicely, it's very expensive, these. This came out on CD as a Japanese import, and Jeff said he would pick me up a copy, which is really nice of him. And he did, and here's the Daphne and Chloe CD, which is what I'm playing. Completely different cover art, completely different title, but the same album. Things get confusing. And he sent me that CD a little while ago. And the booklet in the CD actually shows you that artwork that was used on the LP, like magic. This is a really good Tamita album. I put it in the top two. I really love Bermuda Triangle, but I think it's better than Bermuda Triangle. But I really do have, it's hard to replace my number one Tamita album, which is his album of Debussy music done electronically, which is Snowflakes Are Dancing is the name of it. That's one of the ones, thankfully, is very easy to get, you know, here in America, you know, RCA, I think, pretty sure it's RCA, did put that out on CD. It's beautiful. That's an easy album to get into, even if you're not a Tamita fan. So I've been listening to that. I was actually listening to this in with my Halloween stuff. Not so much that I don't know if it'll become a Halloween album for me. Who knows? It's not something I push. It's something that, you know, I'll see next year when the Halloween season comes around. I'll see if I get the, you know, the urge to listen to this again. It'll create that affiliation with Halloween to me. And it's very possible it will, since the timing of the arrival of the CD was right around Halloween. So that's one of the things that I had in my heavy Halloween rotation, but I'm still playing it, and it's not specifically, you know, in my mind, a Halloween CD yet. But I love it. And a couple other things I've been playing a lot, which is, anybody that watches my channel, this isn't news. The last vinyl thing, which was a real ordeal that I copied over a couple weeks ago, was this duet album, Rendezvous by Richie Byrock. I think it's the only time I've ever seen him listed as Richard Byrock on an album. And George Mraz, the upright bass player, George Mraz, Richie Byrock, the piano player. And one of my favorite album covers of all time. Now, when I saw this in the store, I bought this when it was basically a new release. This was recorded in January of 1981. Released shortly after. I probably bought it before 81 was over, maybe early 82. Flipping through the racks, because this was in the record store days, in the days before CDs, I saw the cover first. And I'm glad it wasn't like a Debbie Gibson album or something, because the cover was so pretty, it's like, I gotta have that regardless of what music's on there. Let's hope it's good music. And then I saw the names, and I knew both Richie Byrock and George Mraz from guitarist John Abercrombie's band. And this was recorded shortly, right around the time of the breakup of John Abercrombie's band. There was a quartet that guitarist John Abercrombie had. Richie Byrock was the pianist. George Mraz was the bass player. And had that in about from 77 to somewhere late 80, maybe even into 81. Possibly, I'm not sure. The band was still in existence at this time in January 1981 when this was recorded or not. But these two guys, you know, made up two quarters of the band and had obviously played together quite a bit. And this was never reissued on CD. Very quiet album, so unfortunately all the vinyl kind of crackle and pops are evident when I transferred it. Because it's such a quiet album. There's no drums in there or noisy guitars or anything to kind of mask the vinyl imperfections. And the funny thing is after I recorded this, I put this album in full up on my YouTube page so anybody could listen to it. and people have said they like it. And Vinyl Spin Jeff even went out and bought a copy. He liked it so much. Oddly enough, despite the age of this, and this has been out of print for many years, the label doesn't exist anymore. There were all of 10 copies still available, and a lot of, you know, nobody really watches my videos in terms of numbers of people, and yet it seems whenever I put an album up, a rare album like this, the only albums I put up are things, old vinyl albums that have never seen release on CD, which I have very few of. But I just got a comment yesterday on a Cal Jader album that I had put up a few months ago, and called Putting It Together. It was a 1973 live album, and there's quite a lot of Cal Jader albums that were never re-released on compact disc, and that was one of them. And so I put that up there, and you know, people have heard it, and not just people that watch my videos, interestingly, but people are finding it. And you know, instead of like my personal videos like this one, at best might get like 50 views after it's up for a couple weeks, the Cal Jader thing, I just got a comment on, which caused me to go back to the video, and I saw it's got over 1,700 plays in the matter of a few months. And this one's got, I think, going on a couple hundred, and this has only been up for, I don't know, a week or two. So people find my vinyl things that I put up, even though they don't watch my videos, per se. So I am doing somewhat of a service, I guess. Would be nice if people watch my videos too. But so this is an album on a record label that I never saw anything else on, called IPA, International Phonograph Incorporated, in Hamden, Connecticut. And looking it up on Discogs, I noticed, I don't even see it here, it must be somewhere, maybe on the vinyl itself, that the catalog number is 1001, which normally would tell you that it's the first release on the label. And according to Discogs, it's the only release on this label. So maybe I'm not surprised why this never was reissued on CD, because the label doesn't exist anymore and there's nobody out there buying up the rights to release it. I didn't realize Richie Byrock, until I looked on Amazon, had so many solo releases out, which may be another reason why this hasn't come out. But he's done a lot in a piano trio with piano, bass, and drums. Not a lot of duet recordings. Duet recordings for him are pretty rare, so I'm really digging this one. I think one of the things that attracts me to it is the cover. It's good late night music because it's quiet. It's just piano and upright bass. There's no drums. Really nice album. You want to hear it, I put it up on my page so you can find it. And the previous, I'm listening to that one a lot, by the way. In fact, more than when I first bought it, I maybe listened to it three or four times and put it up on the shelf. I love the album cover so much, it's never been far, even in my old home, from my view. And yet, in 30 years, I didn't play the record. Now that I transferred it, now I'm playing it like every day. And the previous album that I transferred over, that was a no-show on compact disc, even though it's on A&M Records, a huge record label. I guess, well, A&M Records has a lot of commercial artists, and so I guess if they're looking in their archives to reissue old albums on CD, they're going to do things that make them a lot of money, not things that don't make them a lot of money. So unfortunately, Roger Kellaway's cello quartet, Come to the Meadow, is one that, even though A&M Records is very much still around, they have, it seems, no interest in releasing. And it was an album recorded in 1973, all instrumental. Really nice quartet. It's not actually a cello quartet as in four cellos. It's Roger Kellaway who wrote all the music on piano. It's a guy named Edgar Lustgarten on cello, Chuck DeManico on upright bass, acoustic bass, and Emil Richards on percussion. Mostly marimba and hand percussion, not drums. It's a really nice album, not incredibly well recorded. It's all acoustic, and this is the one album that I always say I wish the ECM Records engineers would have been around to record this, instead of the New York City engineers, because they seem to not have a real good grip on how to record. It's kind of a muddy sounding album, unfortunately. It's great music. is an NPR show, National Public Radio show, that I was surprised that for many years has used called Selected Shorts, and it's used the Come to the Meadow title track as its theme music for years now. But I'm surprised because somebody must have had to dig out their LP in order to transfer it, because this has never seen a CD release. Somebody has good taste over there. And Selected Shorts usually airs on the weekend. It's a radio program of usually like name actors and fairly well-known stars reading short stories. So it's an interesting radio show that I used to catch quite a bit. And they still use Come to the Meadow as their theme song. It's this one I put up too. I transferred it about a year ago. And this is my original copy here. Two of the songs skipped really badly, and I was frustrated as hell because I really wanted to get this so I could listen to it again. You know, do a nice transfer in my computer, burn a CDR of it, whatever. So I actually went out and bought a second used copy of it because I couldn't get rid of the skips that were in those two tracks. So I used this album for this album to transfer some of the songs. The second copy of the album to transfer some other of the songs to get a fairly decent sounding transfer, because I don't think it's ever going to come out on CD. And I listened to it a bunch when I transferred it, quite a lot actually, last year. And then Carm recently told me that he had spun it, and so I had spun his copy of his album. Got me in the mode, and I started listening to it again and again. Got into my nightly playlist. Nice album, nothing avant-garde, kind of pretty music, a lot of it. Not really jazzy, it's all pretty much composed out. You know, there's maybe a couple solos here and there. But I like it. One of those outside oddball albums. Now, no secret to most of the people that watch my videos know I'm not working, so I shouldn't really... Actually, that's one of the things that's driving me to go back into my own archives a bit and pull out albums that I either didn't listen to much or haven't listened to for years out of my archives, because I'm not buying much new stuff. If I come across something, something at a really good price that I can't pass up, because something I really want, I will bite the bullet, and I've made a couple purchases recently that I'll show. But interestingly enough, something made me pull out this album again. And probably the only reason I'm going to mention it is because it's such a good album that I think a lot of people that like kind of electronic music would very much like, regardless of whether you've seen the movie or not. And that's the Solaris soundtrack by a guy named Cliff Martinez. That's George, what's his name? I don't like it. George Clooney. So I don't watch his movies. I've seen two of his movies. Solaris was one of them, because I saw the Russian. It's originally a Russian movie made in the early 70s, and it's a very long movie in Russian with English subtitles on it. It's about 2.5 hours. It's a very interesting, very very well made science fiction movie that every once in a while, like a PBS. Will play. I think that's where I caught it, on PBS, because I definitely saw it without commercial interruption. The Russian version is superior, and because of its length, I think the viewer gets more sucked into the story. It's a very, very well done imaginative story. The American version, done, I think 2001, is not bad though. It's a good movie. I have to be honest, I don't like George Clooney, and the fact that I could overlook that while watching the movie kind of speaks to the movie itself. But watching the movie on cable, this later American version, I was totally floored by the soundtrack. And oddly enough, the soundtrack is still available. Now, soundtracks usually go out of print very quickly unless they contain a pop song on them. So a lot of soundtrack albums you'll get that will have the actual music, the instrumental musical score of the movie on them, a lot of them have one or two or even half and half pop songs. And they're hoping to make some more money by having a pop hit on the album. Well, this one doesn't have any of that because there's no pop songs in the movie, so it's simply the orchestral score. And usually, because this is a perfect example, is I have a ton of Mark Isham CDs, albums, that were from movies. Even when the movies were successful, there was no associated pop songs on them, and it was strictly the instrumental music for the movie that came out, and they were out of print within a year. And apparently, this happened with Solaris, too. When it first came out, the original CD edition came out. I don't think the CD edition was a big hit. The movie was, you know, probably a minor success. So it went out of print. And now, I don't know why, but for some reason, I think it's 2011, not only did it come back in print, but they remastered it, which is a bit odd. You shouldn't really have to remaster something as recent as 2001. But I don't have the old original version of the CD. But reading reviews of it, people say that the remastered CD does sound better, and the remastered CD is all I have. All the songs are the same, the pieces of music are the same. Now, when I first heard the music in the movie, and even when I popped the CD in without reading too much of, you know, the players on it, I thought it was an electronic CD. And Cliff Martinez is essentially like an electronic composer, but basically the whoever wrote the actual music out took I believe what happened is took Cliff Martinez's electronic score and scored it for an orchestra. Now, oddly enough, the orchestra still sounds electronic to me. This is such a fantastic album, though. It blows my mind every time I listen to it. And it's one of those things that I only have gone back to revisit because I'm not making a lot of new music purchases. And it's about 43 and a half minutes. Not long for an album, but that's fairly long for an album that consists solely of a single movie's soundtrack. You know, no pop songs, nothing to break up, you know. And it's one of those rare things that it basically works as an album to listen to. There's very few, if any, things audibly that give away that this is a movie soundtrack. A lot of movie soundtracks have these very, very short segments, and you could tell, well, why didn't they continue making this piece longer? Why does it cut off so abruptly, and there's a lot of, you know, one-minute segments and all that? Well, this has, there's definitely segments on here that are under 3 minutes, even under two in some cases. But there's only 11 pieces, runs 43 and a half minutes. I think in a lot of cases, unless you're really, really finely tuned into it, you may not realize it's segueing from one track to the other. This is a really, if you're a fan of really electronic music, but played with an orchestra, so there's orchestra textures in there. But if you listen to it casually, it still sounds like electronic music to me. The name looked familiar to me when I pulled it out, the Solaris thing, to listen to it again. I realized I do have another soundtrack by Cliff Martinez, a movie called Mark, a movie I've never seen, don't know anything about, from 2003. So this was actually after. And this one does have a pop song on it, naturally, but only one. 17 tracks of the store Cliff Martinez. This isn't bad, but this is pretty good. But, you know, there's a lot of shorter pieces on here. It ends with a pop song, so turn it off before it gets to that kind of thing. And this one gives away a little bit more that it's a soundtrack. You know, you hear some very short, abrupt pieces of music. Why did I buy this, having never seen the movie or hearing the soundtrack prior? Was because I'm such a fan of Peter Maunu, M-A-U-N-U, who played with Mark Isham, but only has come out with one solo album that I know of. And I saw that there was a credit for Peter Maunu on this album. So I decided to buy it because there's so few things with his playing on it. He's played a lot of guitar parts on various Mark Isham albums over the years. He's a very close associate of Mark Isham. Only has the Warm Sounds and Gray Field album, which was from 1990, I think it was, which was his only solo album that has come out, which is a fantastic album. And I love his playing so much. So when I saw that he had a partial credit on here, I decided to pick it up. Well, as it turns out, the credit was he doesn't really play on it. It's an okay album, though. I'm not sorry I have it, but Peter Maunu, I guess is how you pronounce his name, created this DVD-ROM of like guitar atmospheric loops, and made the, you know, and I guess the primary use of this would be for people to use in recording and in music. You know, they could actually purchase this CD-ROM. I guess that this is more for, I guess, music professionals kind of thing, and use these loops, I guess, without paying, you know, any additional money for it, whatever. And so some of his loops were used for the music, so you kind of get to hear some of his guitar magic without him actually having played on the album, if that makes any sense. They just, Cliff Martinez simply used his loops. And this is more electronic. I don't recall how much of an orchestra there is on this. Not bad if you can get it for a decent price and you're really interested in Cliff Martinez. But the Solaris thing, I think, is really... I'm glad I replayed it. You know, I remember... Now I remember watching the movie and really thinking the soundtrack was something special. And then buying the CD. But at that time, I was buying so much music that I gave it a few spins, liked it, and just kind of went up on the shelf. And it's just one of those things that we all have. All of us music lovers have those albums that, you know, we're absorbing so much music, and sometimes we miss things and we forget things. And hopefully sometimes, you know, you go back and, you know, you pull something off the shelf and you're like, wow, why didn't I listen to this a hell of a lot more when I first got it? One of those things. And a couple purchases I made fairly inexpensive is I've gone on about, not too many people are insane like me and actually like a series. And Verve, back in the early days of CDs, created this compact jazz series. And I've been collecting a lot of, I won't say all of them. And Verve Records, you know, which has recorded a lot of jazz artists, is unbelievable with the amount, the ridiculous amount of compilation albums that they put out over the years of the same artists. They have more compilations than they do albums of original material by these artists. They're always kind of thinking of a new, I want to say, gimmick in a lot of cases. And I don't collect them for the sake of collecting the series, you know, but there was something about this was actually their first compilation series called Compact Jazz, which started around 87 or 88. I'll say 87, I think. And went to about 1990, which was the early days of compact discs. And what they did at the time, which made sense, was a lot of these albums that they had by jazz artists that had been recorded for the Verve label were not available yet on compact disc. Compact discs were new, and the record companies were busy manufacturing the new albums, you know, making sure their albums came out at that time. They were still coming out on LP, on vinyl, and cassette, and compact disc for the new albums. So they didn't have a lot of time to go back and just release, you know, re-release every back catalog old item on CD. So instead of doing that, until a lot of these albums did get released on CD, they put together these compilations that were basically samplers of, you know, older albums of a specific artist. And it's a psychological thing, because the first compilation series I fell in love with was the ECM Works series. And one of the things I loved about it was the album artwork, the cover. On the ECM Works, they used the same photograph on every single album of the Works series, except they would change. So it's the same picture, the same painting, kind of, but they would change the tint of it, or it would be the same painting, but done from like an early morning point of view, where you could see like the tinge of sunlight in the distance, or a late night view, where most of it was dark, but you could still see the same picture of a road and everything. It was very cool, and it made me want to buy the whole series and, you know, just lay them out side by side, and you can see the variations on the same picture. Well, Compact Jazz was the same way for me. They had this, I don't have the best examples of it here, But they had this wonderful design, that concept of mixing color with black and white. So it's kind of letting you know this is old music, you know, in a new format. And I fell in love with it for two reasons. I love the artwork on all of these. And like I said, I have about 14 of them. I love the artwork on these. These aren't the best example because this one's almost completely color. But there's there is a black and white photo of Art Blakey in there. I just love the way that they mixed not only color but objects from the time. Like there's matchbooks on there from like the era that the music's from like the 1950s and the 1960s. Playing cards, things like buttons, weird things. That all feature kind of artwork from the era that the music is from. So it seems like a lot of care went into making these. The West Montgomery one has like a car from the era that the music was recorded in from like, the early 60s or so. So I fell in love with them because of the artwork initially. And also, I just realized recently why. Another reason I liked them was because these came out when the compact disc was new, and I was very excited by this new format. So going to a record store was now like, oh, let me see what else has come out on CD. And it just dawned on me really recently that one of the reasons why I love and I'm still collecting these is it reminds me back those early days, like 86, 87, when I first started buying CDs, of the excitement of having that new format and really liking the format. And these kind of harken me back to that period. Because as a compilation, I can't say these are better than any other compilation. They're not. They almost always run under an hour, which is much shorter than the capacity of the CD. So they could include a lot of music, a lot more music than they do. So you could, you know, there's a lot of critical things you could throw at these compilations. But I still collect them because of the artwork and because I now realize of the era that they came out, and kind of reminds me of when CDs were new, and like on a Friday after work, I would go to the record store and I would, you know, go pick up a new CD and things like that, and I would always see these in there because in the jazz world, these were among the first things that came out on CD that weren't brand new albums. So I got this one, and it's really the first. This is a new one I bought, I don't know, maybe $6 or $7 I bought used. And I've never bought used stuff until very recently. But these are impossible to get new because they've been out of print for a lot of years. And so big band drummer Gene Krupa, who I only knew by name. I don't know if I'd ever heard him before. I knew the kind of music he did. He's from that Buddy Rich school, the same age as Buddy Rich. Gene Krupa passed away in 1973. And he was initially a big band drummer. Most of his performances are a little bit later in his career. He was known, I guess, in the 40s. Or 50s. These were a little bit later in his career. But there's some big band stuff here, some smaller band things, and it's the first time I've ever got to actually hear Gene Krupa play. So it's a compilation of things. It's when you don't know an artist, the compilation is probably the best place to start. And so I got this one relatively cheap, and it's got that, you know, that hip. There's some color in there. There's some black and white in there. That cool compact jazz design, and this is going longer than I wanted it to, so I'm going to cut it short. I'm not going to continue now. So hopefully you can hear me, and the music's not too loud and overbearing. I guess I'll find out later. And it's late at night here. It's the witching hour. It's about midnight. I don't know what else to say. I'm going to keep doing videos, and I hope everybody's doing well. Thanks for all your comments and emails and everything. And I'll be back soon talking once again about absolutely nothing. Oh, and I did, you know, I wish I could move my camera. I'm going to move my camera here. You can't see it. Yeah, you can't see it. Maybe you can just a little bit. You see my exercise bike there with the white T-shirt on the seat? And you see a blue thing, not there, but up there. You see that right there where that blue thing is? I didn't think about this beforehand. You can see that gray corner there? That's my keyboard, my high quality keyboard, the best one I have. I decided to bring that in from the garage. That has been in the garage since I moved here. And, you know, my music studio set up. But if you recall my recent video, I had two very expensive electronic units that I didn't bash around that had been stored out in the garage that stopped working. And it was possibly suggested that the cold, you know, because it's out there, there's no temperature control out there. And it doesn't get unreasonably hot in the summertime, but, you know, it'll go down to zero sometimes, you know, whatever it is outside in the wintertime. So it suggested that possibly the electronics were kind of messed with from the cold. And I thought, oh man, what else do I have out there, you know? And that keyboard I can't replace because it's a couple. Oh, you can still see it, actually. It was an expensive keyboard. It's got weighted keys on there and everything. And, you know, it's cold. You know, it's getting cold here now. Now, it's been out there already 4 years. And I haven't even tried to play it for a while now. Well, I did like last year. I mean, I played it about last year. I knew it was still working then. So what I did is, what I had in that corner was I had stacks and stacks of storage boxes with CDs in them. I brought them out into the living room, so that living room was completely full of boxes of stuff I have no place to put. But I moved the keyboard in here, which is where it will stay. And, you know, I wanted to allow it several days for it to acclimate to the temperatures in here before I even tried to mess with it, because if it doesn't play, I'll give up music completely, because my guitar neck snapped recently. I still haven't gotten word about whether that's repairable or not. I got two electronic units that broke that I can't replace, not only because I can't afford them, but one of them's not even made anymore. So it hasn't been an easy time, but I'm letting the keyboard sit there. It's been here for almost about, you know, maybe 5 or 6 days. I'm letting it acclimate. I have my sound module that I brought in into here as well that I use for it, and I'm hoping that keep your fingers crossed for me that everything's going to be okay when I eventually do decide to try it out. And if it works, it'll be great, because it's right here in the room, easily accessible, and I'm trying to push myself a little bit to do some writing. So this went, as all my videos do, much longer than I wanted it to. So I'm going to go. Hopefully you're able to hear me over the music. I can't even hear the music at all, but that was the case last time I made a video, and the music almost drowned me out at times. So it's still a work in progress with me getting the sound mix right here. So I'm going to go. Hope everybody's doing well, and I will be back soon, and I have nothing else to talk about, but I'll be back talking about nothing then, okay? Anyway, whatever. See you guys soon. Take care.